Hey guys, it's TownieSimBuilds here, and welcome back to another episode of Sims 4 Real Lore. In this series, we dive into fascinating destinations from around the world, shrouded in history, mystery, and sometimes a little bit of spookiness. In today's episode, we look into the bizarre and frightening legend surrounding one of Germany's historic locations, the Mausturm, otherwise known as the Mouse Tower. With tales of famine, a sinister bishop, and bloodthirsty rats, what exactly happened in Mouse Tower, a relic of Germany's medieval past? Before diving into today's episode, this episode will discuss some unsettling possible causes of death, so please keep that in mind while watching. On another note, unfortunately, I am not versed in German and other various European languages appearing throughout this video. However, I will do my best to pronounce these different names for you guys. Examining the past of the Mouse Tower, our story is set roughly in 10th century Germany. The Mouse Tower, as it is known today, currently stands on a small island within the Rhine River, located in the city of Bingen. Historically, the island was used as far back as the Roman Empire, where a similar structure once stood. However, through the years, the Mouse Tower has gone through several reconstructions and restorations. The main structure of the tower, as it is pictured today, has roots tied to the 1200s, when it was officially recognized as a toll collection tower. However, its most recent incarnation can be attributed to its last major renovation in the 1800s, giving way to its neo-Gothic appearance. Originally, the Mouse Tower was a standard toll tower constructed during the Middle Ages, one of several built along the Rhine River. Those who operated these towers exerted heavy control over the waterways. Most often, the keepers of the towers would impose a tax on incoming vessels, preventing them from passing without payment. While the practice seemed benign, many viewed the tower keepers as schemers, extorting money from both local residents and foreigners traversing the waters. However, accusations escalated further. Some reports stated that the keepers went as far as stealing ships, robbing those on board, and in some cases, kidnapping passengers. Over time, the negative reputation of the toll towers, traditionally referred to as Mausturm in German, developed a new name, Mausturm, or Mouse Tower. This derives from the German word Mausen, meaning to lie in wait, a reflection of the tower's original primary function as a guard tower, which also provided signals to vessels traveling along the narrow waterways. Therefore, the term Mausenturm was then abstracted into Mausturm, as it is called today. However, the strange new nickname for the tower holds historical significance, with ties to a dark legend surrounding one of the tower's former keepers. While there are some variations on what transpired at Mouse Tower, the tale remains largely the same. The legend of the Mouse Tower takes place in the year 970 AD in Bingen, Germany. At this time, a great famine had been occurring throughout the land, claiming the lives of thousands. Meanwhile, an archbishop known as Hatto II presided over the city of Mainz. Apart from religious duties, Hatto II was responsible for collecting tolls at the Bingen Guard Tower, while also managing the distribution of the city's food supply. According to legend, the townspeople despised Hatto II, who used his power for personal gain with little regard for his people, so much so that he often resorted to underhanded methods to achieve his goals. Unfortunately, this also proved true during the famine, where a grisly fate awaited the commoners of Mainz. As the city's designated food distributor, Hatto II allegedly had sole access to a sizable storehouse, which likely contained grains, fruits, vegetables, and other harvested crops. However, in an act of greed and self-preservation, Hatto II decided to limit the operation of the storehouse, keeping most of its sustenance to his own discretion. Allegedly, he attempted to sell some of the storehouse's goods, placing a steep markup on the supplies and infuriating the townspeople further. Within little time, public uproar rose quickly in response to Hatto II's actions. Some of the commoners pleaded for their lives, begging the archbishop to offer more rations from the storehouse. Others, however, grew hostile, with the possibility of a rebellion against the archbishop himself. Unfortunately, upon seeing the reactions of the townspeople, Hatto II had a diabolical plan to resolve his predicament. Hatto seemingly surrendered to the demands of his people, opening the doors of the storehouse. His decree was simple, to allow anyone to take as much or as little as they could carry from the storehouse itself, for no cost whatsoever. As he planned, the townspeople quickly filled the confines of the storehouse, eager to gather food. Ensuring everyone else was inside, Hatto II would order the storehouse doors to be closed and locked tight, trapping the townspeople within it. In a final sinister act, a large fire was then set, engulfing the storehouse and unfortunately taking the lives of everyone within it. Legend says that Hatto reveled in this dark victory, remarking how the cries of his people resembled the squealing of rats. Returning to his castle and mines that evening, Hatto II celebrated with a large feast, and eventually headed off to bed in his personal chambers. The following morning, however, Hatto II was awoken by an unsettling event. In an eerie twist of fate from his earlier remarks, an enormous horde of rats had descended upon the local area, including the grounds of his estate. The rats had proceeded to devour the remainder of his personal food supply, while allegedly chewing up a painting of the Archbishop himself. Alarmed and frightened, Hatto II attempted to flee from the ravenous horde, eventually making his way to the shores of the Rhine, where the toll tower stood. Being the operator of the tower, Hatto II made his way across the water, likely by boat, granting himself access to the tower's front door, and eventually ascending to the top. The Archbishop assumed himself to be safe from the rats, surmising that they were unable to swim across the water. Ultimately, however, his predictions proved very wrong. The horde of rats, now closing in on the Archbishop, swam through the river and onto the island of the Toll Tower. Despite locking the front door, the rats quickly chewed through it, racing to the topmost floor, where Hatto remained in hiding. In a grim act of poetic justice, the Archbishop was consumed by the rats, perishing within the Toll Tower. In the past few centuries, the legend of the Mouse Tower has been adapted into various works of literature, with one particular version recorded by 18th century English poet Robert Southey. This version was also recorded by 19th century English priest Sabin Baring Gould, included in his popular collection, Curious Myths of the Middle Ages. An excerpt from the poem describing Hatto's impending death reads as follows. He listened and looked, it was only the cat. But the bishop, he grew more fearful for that. For she sat screaming, mad with fear, at the army of rats that was drawing near. For they have swum over the river so deep, and they have climbed the shore so steep. And now by thousands up they crawl, to the holes and windows in the wall. Down on his knees the bishop fell, and faster his beads did he tell. As louder and louder drawing near, the saw of their teeth without he could hear. And in at the windows and in at the door, and through the walls by thousands they pour, and down through the ceiling and up through the floor, from the right and the left, from behind and before, from within and without, from above and below, all at once to the bishop they go. As horrifying as this legend may sound, this tale is actually regarded as a work of fiction, a medieval fable that has been told for several centuries. However, there are many elements of the Mouse Tower legend that are rooted in historical figures and locations. Apart from its murky history as a toll collections tower, the Mouse Tower was said to be managed by a long line of archbishops who held residence in the city of Mainz, Germany. Among these archbishops was, in fact, a man by the name of Hatto II, the main character behind the legend. However, many sources state that Hatto II was not an evil man like the legend made him out to be. Some sources claim that Hatto II made many contributions to Mainz, as well as the surrounding areas. Allegedly, he contributed to the construction of the Church of St. George on Lake Constance, while also giving sizable donations to the monasteries in Fulda and Reichenau. With that said, many speculate that the man described in the Mouse Tower legend was actually Hatto I, whose questionable actions and manipulative tactics made him a true historical villain in the eyes of many. Originally, Hatto I was born in a noble family roughly in the year of 850 AD. At this time, large regions of both modern-day France and Germany were part of the Kingdom of East Franks. Within this kingdom were several lordships that carried some sovereignty, including Swabia, Saxony, Franconia, and Bavaria. Among these territories, Hatto grew up in the territory of Swabia, located in the southwestern region of modern-day Germany. For an unknown period of time, Hatto I served as a Benedictine monk. However, he eventually earned the respect of the East Frank king, King Arnulf of Bavaria. In fact, Hatto was so respected by King Arnulf that he served as the king's most trusted counselor, serving as a royal advisor. This would eventually lead to his title of Archbishop of Mainz, Germany, in 891 AD, just north of his original home in Swabia. Unfortunately, just 8 years after Hatto I's crowning as Archbishop, King Arnulf would pass away, leaving his son, Louis the Child, to his throne. However, Louis the Child was only 6 years old at the time of his father's death. Due to Louis being underage, Hatto was set to be the next in line of power, making Hatto the regent king of the East Franks. He would retain a vast amount of power and political authority while Louis the Child was not of age to rule. With Hatto's newfound authority, his reputation as a ruler was shady at best, using his authority and power to manipulate different parties throughout the region. Likely wanting to extend his control within the influences of the church, Hatto would eventually acquire the abbeys of 𝗂𝗔𝗎𝗅𝗎 and Lorsch, both housing two prominent monasteries. Worst of all, however, was Hatto I's involvement in a feud between the Conradines and the Babenbergs. Both families were of high nobility and were currently in conflict over the ruling of Franconia, a region within the East Frank Kingdom. For unconfirmed reasons, Hatto sided with the Conradines. A battle between both parties in 906 AD proved lethal, killing the head of the Conradines, Duke Conrad the Elder, and two of the three Babenberg brothers. Things take an even worse turn following the battle, however. The remaining Babenberg brother, Count Adalbert, was summoned to court by Hatto I. Originally, Hatto promised Count Adalbert safe passage and safe conduct during their arranged meeting. However, as many sources can confirm, Hatto I lied to the Count, capturing Count Adalbert and killing him upon his arrival. While Hatto's motives are initially unclear, it is very important to note that the sole surviving heir to the Conradines was Conrad the Younger, who was only 10 years old at the time of these events. This would likely give Hatto influence over the young Conradine, who was not of age to rule his family's region. In other words, Hatto could operate the throne as a regent king once more, just like he had done with Louis the Child following King Arnulf's death. For these reasons, Hatto was not well liked by the public, with many who despised his obsession with power, control, and authority. His actions, which extended into manipulation and murder, furthermore made a dark stain on his reputation as a ruler. His dark deeds were so known, in fact, that his death in the year 913 AD at age 63 sparked some very interesting theories. Medieval chroniclers at this time claim that the bishop died from a lightning strike, with no information regarding where the bishop was at the time of his death. In a more unlikely tale, some chroniclers say that Hatto died by the devil's hands, thrown into the volcano of Mount Etna, Italy. While this claim may be overreaching, this explanation has interesting roots in Hatto's history, given that he had formerly accompanied King Arnulf throughout his invasions of Italian territory. Mysteriously enough, Hatto I has no official, verified cause of death. Unlike many historical figures of the past, who often died from illness, warfare, or foul play, his death remains up for debate. A natural death by old age is still another possibility. Meanwhile, the explanation of Hatto's death by a large horde of rats falls into heavy speculation, despite the popularity of the tale itself. While the myth of Germany's Mouse Tower is only partially true, the narrative of rats overtaking despicable rulers was actually very common throughout Europe. A Swiss ruler by the name of Freiherr von Gietingen had a near identical tale to Hatto's legend. During a great famine, he allegedly trapped his citizens in a burning barn. A horde of ravenous rats soon appeared, and Freiherr fled to Gutingen Castle on Lake Constance. Unlike Hatto's tale, however, the tower then proceeded to sink into the water as the rats descended upon him, killing the Swiss ruler. Another similar tale from Poland describes the acts of King Popiel. Several commoners resented the king's ruling, making their complaints known to the public. As an act of retaliation, King Popiel summoned the commoners to the palace, hosting a royal dinner where they could discuss their concerns. However, each of the subjects was then poisoned, their bodies disposed in the nearby Lake Kopolo by King Popiel's orders. Popiel proceeded to enjoy a victory banquet after their deaths. However, in a horrific twist, a large swarm of rats spilled from the corpses of the victims, making their way back to the castle. Popiel first attempted to protect himself by standing within a ring of fire, forming a barrier between himself and the rats. However, this quickly failed, and he fled from his estate with his wife and child. They attempted to seek refuge in a second castle, situated on an island that was likely located on the Baltic Sea. Just like Hatto, the rats would also prevail over King Popiel and his family, consuming them all and killing them in the process. Several more variants of the Mouse Tower legend do exist throughout European folklore, spanning across England, Denmark, and Iceland, just to name a few. Like Hatto's tale, however, these myths are largely works of fiction, with their credibility up for debate. Several of the leaders mentioned are in fact true historical figures, but the real causes of their deaths have been harder to trace, mainly due to the influence of fictional accounts and a lack of records. At the core of these stories, however, there is one element that does hold heavy cultural and religious significance: the rat. Looking further into various European cultures and belief systems, the rat has been associated with many positive and negative attributes. From a spiritual and astrological perspective, rats can represent several desirable qualities, including intelligence, resilience, resourcefulness, determination, and even prosperity. However, rats have been largely viewed under a dishonorable lens, commonly associated with poor hygiene, filth, and illness. Unfortunately, they are often connected to their alleged role in the spreading of Europe's bubonic plague, which occurred during the Middle Ages. Additionally, rats have been associated with the lowest classes of society, often intertwined with immoral qualities such as mischief, trickery, and greed. This negative interpretation furthermore aligns with mentions in the Christian Bible, where rats are regarded as impure creatures and carriers of pestilence. In turn, many biblical tales relate rats to concepts of both destruction and evil. On an interesting note, the rat has also been associated with ancient mythologies, tying rats to more spiritual concepts of death, divinity, and arguably the human soul. In Roman mythology, for example, rats are associated with a lesser-known deity by the name of Eremanius. Often interpreted as a god of darkness and destruction, Eremanius was said to favor rats as his primary animal, with possible correlations to Hades and the underworld. Similarly, rats in Celtic lore are said to be prophetic, having an eye for impending future events. Unfortunately, their abilities often foretell dangerous events that would soon unravel. Rats fleeing from a house, for example, could signal a fire or natural disaster that could soon destroy the home itself. Examining the various beliefs tied to rats and their symbolism, there are strong connections to the Mouse Tower legend and its variants. The rats in the Mouse Tower legend are viewed as a force of destruction to the unjust rulers, serving as both an omen and a form of divine punishment. The rats could arguably embody the souls of those who were wrongfully killed, their spirits now seeking retribution. Furthermore, the symbolism of the rat could even be viewed as an element of poetic justice. A ruler who was greedy, deceptive, and malicious is killed by an animal who is said to represent these same exact qualities. While these interpretations may be up for debate, it is evident that the Mouse Tower legend has heavy roots in both European folklore and mythology, intertwining the symbolism of the rat with a long history of oppressive rulers despised by their subjects. Additionally, as horrific as it may sound, consumption by rats was also a real method of execution in the Middle Ages, which does provide some historical context to these different legends. Whether any of these rulers were actually punished by this method, however, unfortunately is not confirmed. With all the mentions of death tied to Germany's Mouse Tower, there is one question that still remains. Is the Mouse Tower haunted? Unfortunately, there is little to no evidence suggesting that the tower holds any supernatural or paranormal activity, despite a notably long history. The disputed and largely fictitious nature of Hatto's death makes it unlikely that his ghost haunts this location, given that he may have died within town or within his estate. However, given some of the harsher alleged actions of former toll tower keepers, it is possible that lives were lost on the island, potentially due to altercations and reported kidnappings tied to incoming vessels. Despite these possibilities, these activities are not historically confirmed at the site of the Mouse Tower. What is noted, however, are numerous battles involving the tower itself, including invasions of both French and Prussian troops. As a result, the tower suffered heavy damages, and at one point was completely destroyed. It is possible that the tower may have been the location of multiple deaths, including soldiers of various regions. While spiritual activity is possible, the Mouse Tower is now part of a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Therefore, entry into the tower itself is highly limited, which could make paranormal investigation quite difficult. As a result, there is no documented evidence of such activity, with little to no discussion regarding the possibility at all. Despite not being haunted, the Mouse Tower of Bingen, Germany continues to be one of the country's most infamous locations. The legend of Hatto I and the Horde of Rats is one that still resonates to this very day, with many variations across Europe. While we may not know the true story of Hatto's death, the legend will carry on as a reflection of history, serving as a cautionary fable to crooked leaders for generations to come. Alright guys, and that is a wrap on the dark legend of Hatto I and the Mouse Tower of Bingen, Germany. As always, I hope you guys enjoyed learning about the lore and seeing the full build come to life. Now unfortunately, just like many other episodes, I only had the exterior shots of the tower to work with, so everything you see on the inside is not historically accurate by any means and is of my own creation. Just like always, this is still a no CC, no mod, limited pack build, and will be available on the Sims 4 gallery for download. I'll leave you guys now with the final lot specs, along with the final cinematic shots of the build, so you can see how everything turned out in the end. With that said, this has been TownieSimBuilds, signing off. Thank you so much for watching, guys.